Today, we're going to talk about the diversification, systematic risk, security market line, and the CAPM model. Some of the announcement news, such as changing GDP, inflation, interest rate, will affect almost all the businesses or consumers, while others, such as labor strike, or part shortage, they affect one or two firms. So we call the first one as systematic risk, the later one as unsystematic risk. They have different names. Sometimes we also name it market risk or non-diversifiable risk for systematic one, or firm-specific risk, asset-unique risk for unsystematic risk. For example, Trump announced increasing tariff for importing steel from China. Green gas bill will result in an increase of 20% in electric car sales nationally next year. Riders in Los Angeles announced that they're going to start a new strike this Monday. Fed announced a new round of QE, buying an additional $800 billion of treasury securities in the next 3 years. Oil price reached a record high, and grocery store prices go up as well. The demand for cybersecurity jobs will go up by 15% next year. So tell me that, which ones, what do you think, belong to a systematic risk? Which one belong to unsystematic risk? Tariff policies, Fed's monetary policies, oil price inflations. So the 1, 4, 5 systematic risk examples. The electronic car sales, although they affect whole nationwide, but it's only limited to one or two sectors. Riders maybe affect entertainment business. Cybersecurity also is limited in its scope. So 2, 3, 6 belong to unsystematic risk. If you look at the stock movement, some of the stocks they have go up, some go down. So some of the stocks they go up, down at different times. For example, when IBM go up, AT&T go down. When AT&T go up, IBM go down. For those type of stock, the ideal choices for using a diversification strategy. Portfolio diversification is just you're going to include different assets in your portfolios. You want to spread across the risk. Why this will work? Because as you see previously, as long as the stock or securities, they go up or down at a different time, so then we can help each other and we have protection or insurance from one another. So if you add more and more stock randomly into your portfolio, this will become a very diversified portfolio, like index S&P 500, coming from 500 stocks. So in that kind of diversified portfolio, unsystematic risk is very, very small already. Most are already gone. So the risk left, mostly systematic. So if we randomly pick stocks, where the number reach around 30, majority risk is almost systematic. Can we reduce variability without reducing the equivalent amount of returns? Which means that we are able to reduce more risk compared to return. Yes. If it's a proportional reduction, we can just scale back. Then we don't really appreciate the diversification. Can we diversify away systematic risk? Not really, right? It is in every security you selected in your portfolio. Do risky assets always lead to risky portfolio? Not necessarily, as long as they cancel out, they have up or down at a different time. If there are limits on how much risk we can diversify away, the answer is yes, right? We cannot diversify market risk or system. So in the past, we talked about standard deviation is a measure of securities risk. Now, we care more about systematic risk because this is the risk, it's there, we cannot make it disappear. So we want to understand how much is it. So we create additional measure, it's called the beta measure, to measure systematic risk component. It is like a ranking ratio number. Beta measures how closely a stock follows the average market. For example, S&P 500 index. When the market goes up or down, do you behave very sensitively or you are not much affected? The higher the score, the more sensitive against the market. The beta measures how closely a stock follows the average market, such as S&P 500 index. When the S&P 500 goes up or down, how you would respond? Will you go very sensitively or not much affected? So the higher the beta score, the more sensitive you are. We use the market index as our benchmark. So the beta of the market index, S&P 500, is equals 1.0. When we have a beta greater than 1, so implies this asset is more sensitive and has more systematic risk than the average market. For a risk-free asset, systematic risk is 0. Here shows you the chart of price movement of S&P 500, shown in the black one, Amazon stock, purple one, a utility stock, Consolidated Edison, in the red. As you notice, when S&P 500 goes up or change the move, Amazon shows very big movement, while the Consolidated Edison change but not very big into mag. Sometimes the direction are even opposite. So we checked the beta of Amazon stock is 1.71, greater than 1. Consolidated Edison has a beta very, very small. Test your knowledge. We have two stocks, C and K. And the standard deviation of beta information are listed below. Which stock has more total risk? Which stock has more systematic risk? So the core total risk is measured by standard deviation. So K has 30%, a higher standard deviation score. Systematic risk is measured by beta. C has a beta 1.24. Which stock should you have a higher expected? You probably can guess the answer is C. The higher the beta, the higher systematic risk, the higher the reward. We will come back to this statement a bit later. How about you have a portfolio? How do we find out the beta for a portfolio? Simply use a weighted average. Let's look at one example. A portfolio has three assets: risk-free, market index, stock of beta 2.0. Suppose the weight of risk-free is 20%. Weight of market index is 50%. How much did you allocate in this stock? 20 plus 15, the other 30% for stock, right? So we say the weight of stock must be 30% because we only have three in our portfolio. Now, I want you to recall your memory on the special beta. What is the beta for risk-free assets? 0, right? What's beta for a market index? Benchmark, 1.0. So what's beta of this portfolio? So we use weighted average. For risk-free, 20%, beta is 0. Index, 50%, beta is 1. This stock, 30%, beta is 2.0. So this gives us the answer. Another example. Now you have a portfolio, only two assets, a risk-free and one stock. The stock has a beta of 3.0. Question asks you to find out how you allocated your money between the two securities. So the goal is portfolio beta is equivalent to that of market index. Beta, portfolio beta question. So the same formula. What's the beta of a market index? Benchmark, 1. So what is unknown? We don't know the allocation. We don't know the weights. So if we put, say, 30% in the stock, how much you were going to put into risk-free? 70, right? If you put 60, then 40% in risk-free. So the percentage of weights in risk-free is 100% subtract W, right? So let's lay out the equation. The portfolio beta outcomes 1.0 equivalent to the MAC index. We have two assets, risk-free. The weight is 1 minus W. What's the beta of the risk-free? 0. We put W percentage into this stock, has a beta 3.0. So what is our W? 1/3, right? So the rest, 2/3, in risk-free. These are the two portfolio beta examples. Now let's take a look at how should we reward for bearing taking the risk. We mentioned the total risk and the systematic. Should we reward systematic risk or total risk? How about unsystematic? If you say I'm interested in buying Amazon stock, I want to put 100% in Amazon. So that one has a lot of unsystematic risk because it's a one stock. But it is your personal choice. Instead of buying S&P 500, which is very diversified. So it's your own choice, and unsystematic risk can be diversified away. That's when only systematic risk will be rewarded. The rule is the higher the beta, the greater the systematic risk, the higher the expected return reward, and also the higher risk premium. So what is the risk premium again? The return subtract risk-free. I want you to rank the following assets according to the highest risk premium to the lowest. 3 months T-bill, Amazon, beta 1.71, a mutual fund, beta equivalent to S&P 500, McDonald's, beta 0.71. So basically, you probably guessed, it's easy, right? So you're going to rank the one with the highest beta to the lowest. So Amazon first, 1.71. This mutual fund, 1.0. McDonald, T-bill, 0. We wish there's a relationship shows up between the beta and the return reward. So security market line will display the relation between these two. Expected returns and systematic risk beta. The slope of this line, SML, is called the reward risk ratio. It is calculated by the risk premium over the beta. Take a look at these numbers. We have stock A, MAC index, we have the return and the beta risk-free. So using this reward risk measure, we found out stock A has reward risk ratio 7.5. The MAC index also has reward risk 7.5. So means all of them lie in the same line. So the reward risk ratio is also the slope. The slope is equal to 7.5. So what does that mean? It means when you increase your beta by 1, your return reward will increase by 7.5%. So the slope is always a marked risk premium. So we wish there's a quantitative model can capture the relation between this return reward and the systematic risk beta. Indeed, our CAPM model shows us how should we reward according to the beta measure? So based on the risk-free, the systematic risk beta, and the market risk premium. So this model applies for any investment. You can think of securities, real investment, so on. I want you to pay attention to this. So this is a market return. And the difference that's in parentheses is marked risk premium. So once we got this CAPM model, we can compute the returns. So according to SML. So some of the assets, they are priced on this SML. and the sum of them lies above or below. If lies on this line, which means they are fairly priced. So if the lies above means they get higher return than implied by SML. Higher return means you got it at a lower price, you got it at a cheaper price. So this asset is underpriced. Look at C, lines below SML, means C received a lower return than implied by SML. So you probably paid too much. This asset is overpriced. We want now practice CAPM model. Use this model, you can sure find out the reward for any investment. Sometimes you also ask to figure out the beta, or risk-free, or marked return, or marked risk premium. So this question, give us return for the asset is 12%, risk-free 5%, a marked risk premium of 7. The question asks you to find out the beta. So let's use CAPM model. Return is 12, risk-free 5. Beta we don't know. Marked risk premium 7. Does that mean the return on the market 7 or the difference is 7? So the premium is already subtracted, so the whole thing is 7%. So this will give us beta equal to 1.0. Another example. You are given return 16%, the market return 12, beta 1.5, ask you to find out the risk-free. So return 16, risk-free, you just copy down, we don't know. Beta 1.5, marked return 12, again, we copy down risk-free. Now it's pure of algebra. Now I'm copy down these, I'm going to distribute these to both. 1.5 times 12 is 18, subtract 1.5, risk-free. Then I'm going to combine the like items we have. 16 equal to 6.5 risk free plus 18. Then combine these two, we got 0.5 risk free, move to the left equal to 2, risk free equal to 4%. Okay, here's the answer for you to verify. In summary, today we talk about systematic risk, diversification strategy, security market line, and the CAPM model. Thank you.